Exchange Avenue Baptist Church. It is a great day to be in the house of the Lord, and it is Easter Sunday. Happy Easter. He is risen. He is risen. He is risen. Amen. I love saying that and proclaiming it on Easter Sunday, and we get the opportunity to celebrate baptism this morning. So Irma, would you come on down? This is Miss Irma.
And would you step up right there?
Perfect. And this is, as you know, Polo's mom, and she has asked us to baptize her today because she believes in Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior.
Yes.
And we want to celebrate with her this day, and she wants to publicly profess her faith in Christ. So my sister, I'm going to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in beautiful baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. Amen.
Amen.
Amen and amen. I love it. And next, this is very, very special. We have Miss Mariah. Miss Mariah has been attending our youth group since December. And she, on Wednesday night, she was saved on Wednesday night, everybody. Praise God. And on Wednesday night, she ran to me and she said, "Pastor John, I am saved." And so she said, "I want to be baptized on Easter." And I said, "Let's do it, girl." And so, Miss Mariah, do you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Amen. Now I'm going to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in beautiful baptism, raised to walk in the newness of life. I can't imagine another way, a more perfect way to start an Easter Sunday service. Our God is good. The grave is empty. Our Lord is risen, and because of him, we have the hope of a new life in Christ, of an eternal life. Would you pray with me? God, we thank you so much for the hope that we have in Jesus, the life that we have in Jesus, the forgiveness of sin that we have in Jesus. And God, I pray this day that you would help us to see you more clearly, that we would worship you, our God, our King, our Lord, our Savior. Be glorified and honored in all that is said and done. And God, I pray and ask that you would hide us from any distraction that would keep us from worshiping you today. May we see you, may we worship you, may we glorify you, oh God. And in Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Church family, what a great day it is. Would you stand and sing this chorus with us? That Christ is risen. Hallelujah. What a great day it is.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. And all throughout eternity, our song will be the same. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Let's sing. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave, hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave, and all throughout eternity, a song will be the same, hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave.
Sing in joy this morning in victory.
God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon.
Joyous day it is to be in the house of the Lord. If you would, turn to someone next to you, wish them a happy Easter. If you're visiting with us this morning, please fill out a visitor card on the back of your pew, drop it in the offering plate later on in the service. Welcome once again to Exchange. As we continue this morning and as you make your way to your seats, would you join me as we will be reading Luke chapter 24 throughout the remainder of the service, and I'll begin if you'll join with me in worship. But on this first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared, and they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but he has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and on the third day rise." And they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they all told these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home, marveling at what had happened.
That very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him, and he said to them, "What is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk?" And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. And he said to them, "O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken, was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures these things concerning himself.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I made. failures I try to hide.
And we rejoice because the grave, the tomb, is empty. And as we sing this today, we're going to remember Calvary these next couple of songs today. The price that was paid for us so that 3 days later we may have eternal life. Let's sing.
I cast my mind to Calvary when Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone.
And we sing this in truth.
And so praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore.
On the third.
return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Sing this with all you have this morning.
And oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God.
So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he were going farther, but they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is now far spent." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures?" And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, "The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. As they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it before them.
Then he said to them, "These are my words that I have spoken to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day shall rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." And he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he blessed them, he parted from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and continually in the temple blessing God.
Sorrows, Lamb of God, by His own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus' laid.
Silence us.
Silence us, He stood. Will he took a crown of is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me.
Verse in victory, and today we sing it even louder still.
See, the stone is rolled away. Behold the empty tomb. Hallelujah, God be praised. He's risen from the grave. And so that salvation, where your love poured out over me, and now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee, praise and honor unto thee.
Heavenly Father, this day we give you praise. This day we give you glory for what a great day it is that you are risen, oh, our great Savior. We praise you for the victory that is won in Christ Jesus today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen and amen. Church, you sound good singing praises to the Lord. I'm reminded that last year we were unable to meet. And so this year, it is sweet. And I am cherishing every moment that we have together today. For today, we celebrate our risen Savior. For today, we celebrate gathering as a church, gathering as God's people, fellowshipping before Him and each other. And I love it. I love it. I love it. And I just want you to know, hearing the children's voices is beautiful. It's not a distraction, because where there's little ones, there is life, and it is a great thing. So I just want you to know, don't feel bad about that. My question for you this morning is, do you believe in miracles? Do you believe in miracles? I saw an individual post on Facebook yesterday. This individual said, "No God could heal my son." My heart broke. My heart broke, and I thought to myself, wow, they need to read the New Testament. They need to know about my Jesus. They need to know about the healing power of God. They need to know about my Savior. So this morning, do you believe in miracles? Not just a sports miracle, like a hockey team defeating the Russians back in the day. But do you believe in miracles, that God can save a soul? Do you believe in miracles that God can redeem? Do you believe in miracles that God can make new? And if you believe today, what is your belief founded in? This morning we're going to be examining Luke 24. I hope you have your Bibles with you this morning. You could turn in your Bibles to Luke 24. And we'll be examining four reasons to believe the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. Four reasons to believe in the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. And so this morning, can you give a reason for your belief? Can you give a reason for your belief? Jesus performed many miracles during his earthly ministry, but his own resurrection from the dead surpasses them all. The God-man displayed his humanity through his death. The God-man displayed his humanity through his death. In his nature as fully God, by resurrecting 3 days later. He's not just man, but he is God, and he showed himself as the God-man through his death, but also through his resurrection. His claims of deity were validated through his resurrection, and his claim for humanity was validated through his death. Both are needed. The tomb is empty today, my brothers and sisters. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, grave, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which gives us victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. For we need not suffer as those who have no hope, but rather we suffer as those who have hope in eternal life. The resurrection of Jesus is as guaranteed today as your own death. Many of us seek to fight aging. My wife and I, we put on cream on our face to fight those wrinkles. But guess what? They're there. And for me, my hairline continues to recede, even though I pray it doesn't. Heaven forbid. But I cannot fight aging. I cannot fight death. It's coming for us all. It's guaranteed. But another guarantee that each of us have today is that Jesus rose from the dead. And because he rose from the dead, we have hope of an eternal life. You have hope of an eternal life. For your soul is eternal, your body is mortal. But grace be to God who rose from the dead, defeating Satan, sin, and death. And today there is a hope for all of us that not only can our soul be saved, but one day we'll be given an eternal body. One that doesn't age. One that needs no skincare cream. One that need not worry about loss of hair or aches or pains. So today, if you don't believe in Jesus, know this, that our God provides for you healing, he provides for you hope, and he provides for you eternal life. The question at hand is, will you believe? The purpose of this sermon is to examine 4 reasons to believe in the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. And the first reason we heard in the first reading of our text this morning from Luke 24. And the first reason to believe in the resurrection is that Jesus foretold it. And now this is not shared in the first 3 verses of this, but I just want to remind you of this. We look at the first 3 verses of Luke 24. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb taking spices they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. We're going to pause right there. So the ladies went down to the tomb on Sunday. And they went down to the tomb for one reason. They went down to help prepare the body with spices. So the body had not been adequately prepared after death. But notice, what is the intent of the women? They went to the tomb to see the body. But what did Jesus share in his earthly ministry? What did he proclaim? I just want to remind you that in Luke 9, chapter 9, verse 22, Jesus said this, the Son of Man must suffer many things. Not only must he suffer, but he's going to be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law. And he must be killed, and on the third day, he must rise to life. So he said that in Luke 9:22. And then in Luke 9, 43 through 44, while everyone was marveling at Jesus for what he had done, he said to the disciples, verse 44, "Listen carefully to what I'm about to tell you. The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men." And then again in Luke chapter 18, verses 31 through 33, Jesus took the 12 aside and said to them, "We are going up to Jerusalem, and everything that is written in the prophets about the Son of Man will be fulfilled." Verse 32, "He'll be delivered over to the Gentiles. They will mock him, they will insult him, they will spit on him, and they will flog him and kill him, and on the third day he will rise again." So Jesus, in the Gospel of Luke, he foretold of his own death three times. But he didn't just foretell of his death, he also said, guess what? The Son of Man is going to rise and be alive. He will not be held or bound by death. So the women went on the third day expecting to see the body. But you know what they did not do? They did not believe the words of Jesus. So the first reason I believe in the resurrection is because Jesus said it. And if Jesus said it during his earthly ministry, it's a guarantee. It's good as done. So just as Jesus said he was going to raise himself from the dead, he will also come back. Jesus is coming back. He's returning. And just as guaranteed his resurrection from the dead, it's as guaranteed of his return, calling the church to himself, coming back not as the baby in a manger, but rather as the king, the king of kings, the Lord of lords, the supreme being, for he's God. And he will judge the world of its sin. He's coming back. But do you believe his words? For in this moment, we see the Marys not believing his words. But I believe because Jesus foretold his death. Let's look at the second reason to believe in the resurrection. The angels announce it. So the Marys go down to the tomb and they bring spices because they expect to see that there is going to be a body. But they go down to the tomb and they don't see a body. Rather, they see that the stone has been rolled away. And it's amazing that there was even a stone there. But the stone has been rolled away, and they go in, and they don't see a body there, but rather they see linens folded. And they marvel at what's going on, and then all of a sudden, an angel appears to them. So what is an angel? A supernatural announcement. Let's not just read this from Bible eyes, but if you saw an angel today, would it kind of shake you? If you're walking around and you don't see something you expect and an angel appears before you, I think you would all be shook. I would be shook. I think I would even be a little terrified. The ladies fall down on their face. They were terrified. They were shook. But let's examine the words of the angel. What is this supernatural announcement? This is in the second half of verse 5. We'll start at the beginning so you can find it. Verse 5, "And they were there frightened and bowed their faces to the ground. The men," those are the angels, "said to them, 'Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but he has risen. Remember how he told you while still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinners and be crucified and on the third day rise?'" Notice in verse 8, they remembered his words. They remembered his words. So the validity of Jesus raising from the dead is still his words, the first aspect of the sermon. But there's a supernatural announcement now that is proclaiming the validity of Jesus' words. And the supernatural announcement comes by a messenger of God, an angel. And this messenger of God says, "Why do you seek the living among the dead?" Let's pause. Were they seeking the living among the dead? They were seeking the dead among the dead, right? They brought spices to put on his body.
So they sought the dead among the dead, but the angel said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead?" In saying that, he's saying, you should be looking for the risen Savior. He's not dead. Don't you remember? He foretold that this was going to happen. And what happened? They remembered. They remembered and were so excited that they ran to the disciples. And when they ran to the disciples, they said, "We just saw some angels, and the angels told us that our Messiah, Jesus, has risen from the dead." And what did those disciples say? Oh, this is an idle tale. Oh, I don't believe it. And Peter got up, and he ran to the tomb to validate the claims of the women. So this morning, will you believe because Jesus foretold his death? Will you believe because the angels told of his resurrection? Will you believe because witnesses of this angelic pronouncement made clear to the disciples that Jesus had risen from the dead? Or we have to validate it for yourself. These disciples, specifically Peter, did not believe these words. But he had to go see it for himself. Today, you can see the Holy Lands, but you can't validate these claims. We have to believe based upon the Word of God. Will you place your faith and trust in Him and His Word? The first reason to believe in the resurrection of Jesus is because he foretold it. The second reason to believe in the resurrection is the angels announce it. Let's look at the third reason to believe in the resurrection. It's because the Old Testament teaches it. Let's jump down in Luke 24. This is now on the road to Emmaus. So the women went to Jerusalem and they proclaimed there in Jerusalem to the disciples that Jesus had risen from the dead, and that they had seen some angels, and they had heard this news. But now some disciples decided not to go look at the tomb, but rather they decided to leave Jerusalem and go to Emmaus. And while on the road to Emmaus, they're discussing what had taken place over this past week. As they had seen their Savior, their Messiah, go to the cross and be rejected and be crucified, and now they're now trying to make sense of this claim that their Messiah wasn't still dead, but he is now risen. And so on the road to Emmaus, I just want you to look with me. Starting in verse 17, Jesus comes up to them, but they did not recognize him. And it says this: Jesus comes up to them and says, "What is this conversation that you are holding with each other?" And they look at him and say, for they were looking sad. Then one named Cleopas answered, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" I love this about Jesus. He's just prodding them. "Hey, what are you guys talking about?" "What things?" He knows all things, but he wants them to proclaim it. "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth," they say, "the man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and men, and now the chief priests and the rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and be crucified. But we had hoped that he was going to be the one to redeem Israel." Wow. They had hoped he was going to be the one to redeem Israel. And so they then say, "We had heard that he had been risen from the dead. The ladies came from the tomb, and they saw some angels." And notice what Jesus says. Jump down to verse 25. He says to them, "Oh, foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken!" Exclamation point. "Was it not necessary
that the Christ should suffer these things and then enter into glory, his glory? Look at verse 27. This is the key. And beginning with Moses and the prophets, he interpreted to them all the scriptures, the things concerning about himself. So the third reason to believe in the resurrection is because the Old Testament teaches it. Not just Jesus' words in the New Testament do we find the resurrection. Not just from an angel's announcement do we find the resurrection. But throughout the Old Testament, starting with Moses. And Moses, he wrote the first five books of the Bible. So what is Jesus saying? From the beginning to now, the scriptures proclaim that the Christ is going to suffer and die and be delivered. But then he will rise, defeating Satan, sin, and death. Not only will he rise, do they proclaim, but they also proclaim that he will return. And that there will be a kingdom that he will establish on earth. And there will be a kingdom where there will be perfect peace, where the lion will lay with the lamb. And that is what we look forward to. So the Old Testament proclaims not only his first coming, but his second coming. And I would have loved to have been here. I have spent many years in school studying the Bible. Too many. I'm still in it, honestly, and it's sad to say out loud. Too many years, too much money spent. And I would have loved just to sit there with Jesus and have him open my mind and my eyes to understand the scriptures. Can I tell you something today? God provides for each of us the Holy Spirit. And his Holy Spirit speaks to us, teaches us as we read his word. Are you a man or woman of the book? Do you believe the word of God? And do you allow the word of God to read your heart? Do you allow it to convict you of sin, of wickedness, of evil, and to cleanse you and make you new? Does the word of God change you? Or is it collecting dust on your shelf? My friend, my brother, my sister, we must be people of the book. We must wear out the pages of God's word, because throughout the scriptures, they point to Jesus. They point to Jesus' first coming, they point to Jesus' second coming, and in his second coming, he's reigning and ruling for all eternity. And I want to be on the right side of history. Can I tell you something? Our society right now is saying that we need to be on the right side of history when they're wrong. The right side of history is Scripture. Because guess who holds all history? God. Guess who holds the things in his hands? God. And guess who's going to redeem the world and judge sin? God. And then he's going to make a new earth? God. And he's the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He is the right side of history. I want you to note that Jesus, in verse 29, went and stayed with them in Emmaus. And when he stayed with them, they went to a table and he broke bread and blessed it, and he gave it to them. Look at verse 31. It says their eyes were opened and they recognized him. They had yet to recognize him as the risen Messiah. And then verse 32. They said to each other, did our hearts not burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened the scriptures? And they arose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. For they were going to stay in Jerusalem, they were going to stay in Emmaus that night, and then they're probably going to journey home. Because they had traveled to Jerusalem for the Passover. But because Jesus appeared to them, they returned to Jerusalem that night, that moment. There's urgency within them. And they went to then communicate and share to the disciples that Jesus actually rose. For now they believed. Now they believed what the ladies had proclaimed. Now they believe what the angels had proclaimed. Now they believe what Jesus foretold when Jesus appeared to them. So they go into the upper room. And they go to proclaim what Jesus had done for them. The fourth reason to believe in the resurrection. Jesus displays it. This begins in verse 36. And as these disciples who went to, who met Jesus on the road to Emmaus, were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said, "Peace with you." Can I tell you, Jesus, when he returns for the second time, will not say, "Peace with you." The only time that Jesus makes his peace known is now. And so we must be willing to receive his peace today. When he returns and comes down to earth for the second time, he comes as the righteous judge who is going to judge all for the sin that they have committed. So if you want to stand with God and have peace with him today, believe in him. The question at hand is, what will it take for you to believe? He proclaims peace. But notice, the disciples, they were startled and frightened. And they thought they saw a spirit. They thought they saw a ghost. It can't be the risen Savior because he just appeared before us. This must be a ghost. So Jesus, knowing their heart, Jesus, knowing their thoughts, what does he do? And Jesus said to them, "Why are you troubled? Why do doubts arise in your hearts?" He knows their thoughts. "See my hands and my feet. See, it is myself. Touch me. See. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." So he doesn't just say touch and see, but look, let's go on. "And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet." Verse 41. "And while they still were in disbelief for the joy were marveling, he said to them, 'Have you anything to eat?' And they gave him a piece of bread and boiled fish. He took it and ate before them." So what is he doing in this moment? Touch and see. Believe, I'm not a spirit. Touch and see, know that I am God and I have flesh and bones. And then he doubles down and he says, "Do you have anything to eat? Do you have anything to drink? Let me show you that I'm not a spirit by eating and drinking with you." What Jesus is doing for the disciples is saying, "What must I do before you for you to believe?" And so as we are reading Jesus' words this morning, the same question is at hand. What must he do before you for you to believe? That's the question at hand. And guess what? He doesn't just stop at, "Hey, touch my hands, see my side, touch my feet, let me eat, let me drink before you." Let's continue. He then says in verse 44, "These are the words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." What does Jesus himself double down upon? His word. His word that he spoke while he was with them. His word in the Old Testament. He doubles down that his word is true. And what he's saying is, do you believe? And then he opened up their minds to understand the scriptures. And he says, thus it is written that the Christ should suffer on the third day, rise from the dead. Here's the important part for us today. And that repentance and forgiveness of sin should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. Verse 50. And he led them out as far as Bethany. Lifting his hands, he blessed them. And while he blessed them, he departed from them. And he was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him, and they returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and were continually in the temple blessing God. Jesus showed them that he had risen from the dead by letting them touch his hands and his wounds. Notice, he is alive, but he still has the wounds of his crucifixion. He will be the only marred body in heaven. When we go to heaven, when we have our new bodies that are eternal, for our bodies now are mortal, we will be given a perfect body, but there will be one that is marred, and that is Christ's. Because we will remember that he died for us, that he saved us, for us to have union with God. Even in his resurrected body, he still has the wounds, for in those wounds are God's glory. So he shows his wounds. He eats with them. He drinks with them. And then, to show his ultimate power, he ascends and goes to heaven. He shows them where he is. He shows them where he goes. He shows them that he is alive, that he is well, and that he is now seated at the right hand of God on his throne. Amen, hallelujah. And when you read Revelation, after the first three chapters that are books to the church, you hit chapter 4 and chapter 5, and you know where you go to? You go to the throne room of heaven. And when you go to the throne room of heaven, you see the glory of God. And then you see the one that looks like a lamb that was slain. Well, who was the lamb that was slain? Jesus. And what does the one who looks that way do? He grabs the scroll, which is the title deed of the universe, for he has all power and all authority, and he opens it. And his judgment is then poured out upon the earth. He is in complete control. He laid his life willingly down for us that we may believe. The question at hand is, what will it take for you to believe? Now, I know I'm speaking to many Christians this morning. And you might be sitting in the back of your mind, well, Pastor, I believe all of these things, so I didn't even need to hear these four reasons. Well, I want to remind you of them. But then, did you hear the commission that we have from the text? The reason Jesus rose from the dead, verse 47, did you hear it? And that repentance and forgiveness of sin should be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. We gather today because the saints of old have proclaimed the repentance of sin and forgiveness is available in the name of Jesus throughout the generations. And now we are here today, witnesses to the resurrection. We are witnesses who are here to proclaim the good news of Jesus. So if you believe, and you might be saying, Pastor, I believe, then be a witness of Christ. Be a witness of Christ at school. Be a witness of Christ at work. Be a witness of Christ in your family. Be a witness of Christ at the grocery store. Be a witness of Christ when you're driving down the highway and someone cuts you off instead of waving another finger. Not being a witness of Christ.
Be a witness of Christ. And by being a witness of Christ, you are going to call people to repentance. You're going to call people to the reality that they are a sinner and in need of a Savior. You're going to point them to Jesus. For you today, my brothers and sisters, are a witness to the resurrection of Christ. For we have heard his word. For he foretold it. The angels announced it. The Old Testament teaches it. And Jesus has displayed it for us this morning. So Christian, will you today display the resurrection? Will you today proclaim the resurrection? Will you today live as the light of the world that God has called you to be? As the little children's nursery rhyme goes, shall I hide my light under a bushel? No, I'm going to let it shine. Have you been hiding your light? Does anybody know that you're a Christian? Maybe you need to take a step of faith. Maybe you need to put your faith into action and allow your faith in Christ to transform your life. Christian, let us be witnesses to the resurrection. And if you're here today and you've never placed your faith and trust in Jesus, my question for you is, what will it take for you to believe? For our God is a God of miracles, and the chief miracle of his life was that he rose from the dead. Any other God that is proclaimed here on earth is dead. Any other prophet who has walked that's not in Scripture has died. And they're leading men and women astray. And Jesus proclaims that he is the way, he is the truth, he is the life. And there's no one who can come by or come to the Father but through him. And so today, my plea for you is believe. Believe that he came. Believe that he lived the perfect, sinless life for you. He died for your sins, and now today he is seated in heaven, and he's going to come back, but come back in judgment. So today is a day of salvation, and my plea with you is to believe. Believe his word. Believe a supernatural announcement by some angels. Believe the Old Testament. And believe his display. Will you stand with me? We are going to sing a song. And during this song, we are going to have a time to respond. The time to respond isn't just for someone to respond in salvation. But this is a time that if you're going to place your faith and trust in Jesus, that we ask that you respond where you're seated, but then come forward to announce that you believe in Jesus. Walking down the aisle doesn't save you. What you do in your heart, the faith that you have in Christ, saves you. But walking down the aisle puts some feet to your faith. Walking down the aisle says, I believe and I want to know what it means to walk with God. And I would love to connect you and help you walk with God. But also, Christian, we must respond. We must respond, for we are all and should all be convicted, because Christ was a witness. The disciples, they needed a lot to believe and to be called into action. And we have everything that they had. We have the Holy Spirit. We have the Word of God. Will you be a witness of God? Will you step up? Will you repent and ask for forgiveness? Will you respond this day? Will you pray with me? Our God, we thank you For your word that is living and active, sharper than a two-edged sword, and I pray this day you would make yourself known, that you would move within our midst. God, if there is anyone who does not know you as their Lord and Savior, may they place their faith and trust in you, O God. We know you are mighty to save. We thank you, God, for giving us your word that helps us believe. And Lord, if there's anyone here today that does not know you, convict them of their sin and help them repent. Draw them to you, O God. May they seek you. And God, for all who believe, will you strengthen us as you strengthened Christ before he went to the cross? Will you strengthen us, O God, to walk with you? Will you strengthen us, O God, to be your witnesses of your resurrection? Will you strengthen us, O God, to be your examples to a lost and dying world? And may we live boldly and proclaim of your good news, the hope we have in you. Call us to action, O God. Use us, O God, we are willing. And in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Come as the Lord leads.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living.
Who could imagine?
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages sent down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken.
So thankful that you have joined us this Easter Sunday. And if you are here today and you are visiting with us for the very first time, or maybe you've been visiting with us for a while, please, please fill out one of the Connect cards that is in the back of your pews and drop it in the offering plate as we go today. I will make note that we are currently taking our offering on our way out, so the offering plates are on your way out the door. A few of our ushers will be holding those for you, and you can just drop offering in there, or you can give online at exchangeokc.org. In addition to that, if you are visiting with us, I want to encourage you greatly that we have a place for you here at Exchange, whether it's a little one or, you know, whatever age you are. Come join us. We would love to have you here at Exchange, no matter the age. We have places for everyone, from kids to student ministry to adults. Come join us this week. This Wednesday night, we have our discipleship time for all age groups at 6 p.m. That's a great time to plug in. On your way out today, I want to make note of a couple of things. There is a men's retreat watch party sign-up sheet out in the hallway. If you are interested in getting involved in our men's ministry here at Exchange, sign up for that. The cost is $25. We would love for you to come hang out and enjoy a time of fellowship with other believers that day. The cost is $25, and we will be including lunch with that cost. So don't miss out. I'm excited to have fellowship together. Also, a couple things here in-house today that I want to make note of. On your way out, we have a photo booth set up out here in the hallway. We would love, love, love for you to take a picture with you and your family, and feel free to post that on social media. Share that you are in the house of the Lord today, this Easter Sunday that He is risen. Also, including our closing today, I should say, kids, if you are a kid who is here today, make sure you don't leave without getting a nice little goodie bag. We'll have those available on your way out today. If you haven't gotten one already, make sure you stop out there and grab one. We have plenty left, so make sure you get one on your way out today. Church family, He is risen. He is risen. Let us go in victory and celebration. John has a presentation for us.
Absolutely. Lastly, I'd like to introduce you guys to Mike and Donna Tonneby. They have joined our church today. Mike and Donna have been here for, been attending for a few months. I think 9 or so, on and off. Yeah. So since June of last year, since we reopened. And they decided to come back and be a part of us. Mike grew up in the area, in the courts, and he has had a desire to come back here, to come back home, and they want to serve here, and they want to help us as we seek to make disciples of not only those who are in our church, but reach our community. And so we are going to be better because we have Mike and Donna. So they will be out in the foyer, so make sure you give them an Exchange family welcome out there, and we are just excited. We are better because we have them a part of our church. Preston, will you pray for us?
Absolutely. Would you stand with us as we pray? Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for this day that you have made, Lord. We rejoice because we have victory in the empty tomb. Lord, we're thankful for this day of celebration, and we ask that as we go, that we would be faithful to not hide our light, but Lord, share the good news that comes through you, the salvation that is available to all. Lord, we thank you and we love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a happy, happy Easter, everybody.